believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. afresh on me. Come wake me from my sleep. Oh, through the caverns of my soul, flow in me to overflow.
I want to welcome each and every single one of you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why don't we just be seated and let's take a moment just to pray. Pray to the living God. Do you believe that God is here in this place? Because He is. We are not here to observe anything, and this is not a concert. I am not a motivational speaker. We are here to worship the living God. We are here to worship the living God. Allow me to read one psalm for us. It's Psalm 150, and it reads like this: Praise the Lord. Praise God in the sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with lute and harp. Praise Him with tambourine and dance. Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with sounding cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If at this time we could just lift up our voices and let's pray to God. Again, we're not here to observe anything. We're not here as mere spectators, but we're here as participants, worshiping the living God. Worshiping the living God, and He's here and He's in the midst of us. Let's lift up our voices and let's tell God just how great He is, just how awesome He is. Let's worship the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we worship You. God, we bless You. God, how awesome and great and mighty You are, O God. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless the Lord. Praise His holy name. We praise Your holy name, O God. And we just want to say that there is none such as You. There is none like You. God, You rank alone. You are in the league of Your alone. And God, You are so good, so gracious, so kind. Who is there like You, O God? Lord, we pray that we would not worship a small God, a God of our own imagination. But Lord, may we see from Scripture just how great and awesome and mighty that You truly, as You truly are, O God. May we exalt You to the highest heavens, O Lord. We will worship You for Your greatness. We will worship You for Your great salvation towards us. We will worship You for every breath that we take. We will praise You and worship You for every good and perfect gift comes from You. God, may we not come before You presumptuously. May we not come before You thinking that we're doing You a favor. God, but would You be revered and feared in this place. Be worshiped, O God, the living God. We bless Your name, O Lord. If we could just pray once more. Let's pray that our hearts would be opened to receiving the Word of God. Don't think that your duty is fulfilled by coming to church. Coming to church is merely half the battle. But if you come to church and you're just here, present, just filling and occupying a space, and you just go back home unchanged, it's good for nothing. Many people throughout history have come to church and they've left unchanged, unsaved. merely religious. May we not be religious. Let's pray that God would speak to our hearts. I'm merely a man, but I'm explaining the word of God. The pastors, the preachers, they're merely people. We're just men, but we explain the word of God, and therein lies the power, the word of God. Let's pray that we would be opened, our hearts would be opened to receiving the truth of God's word. If we could just pray once more. Gracious God, open up our hearts. Open up our hearts, O Lord God. God, we are desperately in need of you. God, you see that, Lord, if we are left to our own devices, if we are left to our own will, God, we cannot do it. Lord, we're dead in our sins and trespasses. What can we do? What can we do? You need to open up our eyes, Lord. Father, Father, open up our eyes, O Father. Gracious Father, open up our eyes. Help us to hear your voice. You are the good shepherd. And your sheep will hear your voice. I believe your sheep will hear your voice. Be merciful, be gracious unto us, O God. Awaken us, O Lord. God, an everlasting change, a true change, O Lord. Heavenly Father, God, we bless you and we worship you and we extol and we exalt your name. God, what is man that you are mindful of him? And what is the Son of Man that you should care for him? God, why in the world should you receive our praise? We, who are sinners, why should you receive our praise, O Lord God? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you that we weak and feeble human beings can gather here to worship our living God. And we thank you that you call us sons and daughters, and you have given us the greatest gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the costly blood of your Son. Thank you, Lord. We who deserve death, thank you, O God. God, what a mercy and what a grace it is that we could worship the living God. And we pray that we would not squander this time, that we may not come here listening with skeptical ears, but that, God, that you would give us humble and broken hearts. May we be like beggars, ready to receive any morsel of spiritual food that we could receive, God. God, we are beggars. This is who we are. Have mercy upon us, Lord, we pray. We thank you, God. We bless you, Lord. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we're going to be having scripture reading. If everybody could rise for the reading of God's word, and the scripture reader will come up to read the word of God.
The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards them and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one when I meant said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit comes down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one." The word of God.
Praise God. The title for today's message is "Behold the Lamb of God." In the NIV, it says, "Look, the Lamb of God." But I think the ESV that I usually read from creates this dramatic statement. Behold, Behold the Lamb of God. If you are unfamiliar with Christianity, let's say you come from an atheistic or Hindu, Buddhist background, and you have no familiarity with the Christian gospel or the Bible in general, you listen to a statement like this, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and you're going to be deeply confused. Why are we talking about lamb? Why are we talking about sheep and take away the sin of the world? What are we talking about here? But I believe that this is the crux and the heart of Christianity. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. In fact, if we are to qualify ourselves as Christians, that is, if we are to truly be Christians, we must behold the Lamb of God. We must behold the Lamb of God. We're going to see later in Scripture, but the Lamb of God, we're going to learn, is a person, and it's the person of Jesus Christ. He's referred to as the Lamb. Last week, when the pastor was here, we heard a message about the Messiah, or the Christ, Greek, the Christ. The same word in the Hebrew is Messiah, same word, Christ, Messiah. We, just to jog our memories a little bit, if you remember what Pastor June preached, Andrew, which later turned out to be one of Jesus' disciples, he tells his brother Peter, or Simon Peter, perhaps the most exciting news that a Jewish person of this day can possibly share with another person, which is, Peter, we have found the Messiah. We have found the Messiah. You know, I wasn't here last week, I was just listening to the message on YouTube, but as Pastor June was preaching, I began to see God's overarching purpose in all of history. You know, as the Word of God was being delivered, it seemed like to me, as I was listening, all of history, 2,000 years of history, was building up and building up. There was anticipation growing and growing for the coming of the Messiah. You know, there were many kings throughout Israel's history, but no king, as we know, could fit the royal shoes of the Messiah king. There were many priests, right? Many high priests, but no priest could be that one true high priest. There were many prophets, minor prophets, major prophets, many prophets, but no prophet could fit the description of the prophet that Moses had foreseen. There were many kings, there were many priests, there are many prophets. Hopefully this is a reminder for you of last week's message, but none of them could actually live up to the Messiah. They were not the Messiah. In fact, they pointed to the Messiah. So all 39 books of the Old Testament, all together, it's as though each book, each godly person in each book is just anticipating and waiting and groaning and longing for the Messiah. It's as though every page of Scripture is just seeking for the Messiah to come. The plot is thickening. The expectation is multiplying. But you get to the end of the story, you get to the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi, and then it seems as though everything just kind of just falls flat on its face. The last words of the book of Malachi is utter destruction. Utter destruction. That's not very hopeful. That's not very bright. That doesn't seem like the Messiah has come and is victorious over the nations. It kind of falls flat. In our Bibles, Malachi is the last book, but in the Hebrew Bible, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, which is actually one book together, that's the last book. How does that book end? Not great either. In that book, Israel, they disobey God, And so they're exiled from their land. They're taken captive into a foreign land. And there, they finally get to come back into their homeland, but it kind of ends as a cliffhanger. And if you're a person who reads the Bible, you say to yourself, waiting for the Messiah in your heart, what's going on? What's going on? And it's kind of anticlimactic, and it's kind of sad if you think about it. However, we come to the New Testament, and there is a figure that we actually just read about today. His name is John the Baptist. There was 400 years of silence between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew, dividing Old Testament and New Testament, 400 years where God did not reveal anything to his people. And so there is a great silence, and yet there is this figure, John the Baptist. He comes bursting forth into the scene, and he has a message to share. And it's this message: the Messiah is here. The Messiah is now. Prepare your hearts. Prepare your hearts, each and every single one of you, because the Messiah has come. The kingdom of God is now. Be baptized and repent, every single one of you. That was his message. Can you imagine just how provocative it is? Just how exciting it is? And if you have a skeptical ear, you might be thinking, is this true? If you're someone who is easy to receive, which may not necessarily be a bad thing, you may be excited. I think Andrew was ready to receive. But that was John's message. The king is here. The Messiah king, he's finally here. The one that the prophets of old, that the priests of old, that the kings of old were pointing to, he's here, he's now. And that, fully convinced of this, Andrew goes and tells his brother, we have found the Messiah. We have found the Messiah. And I'm sure they didn't have a full picture of who the Messiah was and what he was supposed to be, but they knew this much from the book of Isaiah, because this is very famous about the Messiah. I'm sure every Jewish boy and girl would have known this during this day, that the Messiah would be the Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of the government and of peace, there will be no end. Peace, ushering in a period of peace, not just a period, an eternal peace. Peace where there will be no end. We have found the Messiah, Andrew says. I want to ask you today, have you found the Messiah? Have you found the Messiah? You might say, what do you mean? The Messiah is already here. We just read that the Messiah came. No. Have you found the Messiah? And it's perhaps the most important thing, or the most important person that you can find. Let me ask you, what is it that you're searching for in life? Many of us here, we're in college. What is it that you are longing for? What is it that you are searching for? And what is it that you believe will bring about deep contentment and satisfaction to your soul? You know, when I was in college, this was the question that I was asking myself, and I could not come to a satisfactory answer to. What brings me deep, deep contentment, and what brings satisfaction to my soul, and what is the meaning and the purpose of life? It's only when I became a Christian that all of these answers were met and fulfilled. But if you're still on the fence and if you're still unsure, I can assure you and I can guarantee you this: nothing on this earth will bring you deep satisfaction for your soul. And you could hear it from the pastor, you could hear it from the pulpit, but perhaps you need to crash and burn in your life, searching for these things, seeking for these things, only to find out in the end that it's not there. Perhaps we need to experience it for ourselves, but your education and your grades will not bring you satisfaction. The thing that you're studying for, your profession, that you think will bring you satisfaction, it will not bring you satisfaction. Your friends, at this age, we're all about our friends, more than our family a lot of times. Our friends will not bring us satisfaction. Or perhaps boyfriend, girlfriend will not bring us satisfaction. Your family now cannot bring you satisfaction. You'll say, if only my family could stay together, or if only my family were better. Your future family, so your spouse and your children that you will have in the future, you think that's going to bring you fulfillment? No. None of these things can bring us deep and eternal satisfaction. That satisfaction can only come from God, from Jesus Christ, our Messiah. So again, I ask you, have you found the Messiah? You know, you might think that this topic is not that important, or you might think that, you know, I'm kind of content in my life right now. Maybe I don't really need the Messiah. You know, school's going fine for me. I have a lot of friends. I can't say I'm super, super happy, but I'm pretty content in life. Let me ask you this. What about your sin? What about your guilt? What about your shame? What do you do about that? Every religion tries to remedy their guilt, their sin, and their shame. But when you go to sleep at night, when you put your head on the pillow, what do you do about your sin and about your guilt? What do you do about a guilty conscience? Will just ignoring it? Will time simply absolve all of that sin and shame and guilt in your heart? The Bible says that sin is the greatest problem of all mankind. And it plagues us all. It doesn't matter what culture. It doesn't matter what generation. It doesn't matter if we're living in the 21st century, like right now, or 1,000 years ago. The greatest problem of mankind is sin. And it's because God is holy. He's pure and he's just. And he does not tolerate sin. So the Bible tells us today, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And John the Baptist is referring to the Messiah. So let's go into the text, verse 29. The next day he saw, that's John the Baptist, he saw Jesus coming towards him. So the scene kind of begins with Jesus approaching John the Baptist. John the Baptist, it's more of John the Baptist's point of view. And Jesus, this mysterious figure who we know is the Word, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, he's coming. Jesus is here. He's coming towards John. And this huge section from verses 19 to 34, it's about the witness of John. John the Baptist, who is John the Baptist? Well, like his name describes, he was a baptizer. He baptized people. But, you know, he was actually the older cousin of Jesus, if you didn't know. He was actually kin with Jesus. And he had a very, very important role in the life and in the ministry of Jesus. In fact, his very existence, I believe, on earth was for the purpose of preparing the way of the Messiah for Jesus Christ. If Jesus is the king, then he's like the king's herald who runs into the town square and says, the king is coming, the king is coming, the king is coming. And then he would get everybody's attention. And everybody would know, oh, this is the king's herald. He's the royal herald. And he's pointing to the king. John the Baptist was like a pointer to Jesus Christ. He didn't exist for himself. He was a pointer to Jesus Christ. It was as though he wanted to say, I'm a nobody. Let me be transparent. If Jesus is the light, let him shine through me. But let not I be noticed. So when people came and asked John, who are you? Why in the world are you baptizing? Tell us right now, who are you? He said, guys, I'm just a voice. I'm just a voice crying out in the wilderness. I'm a nobody. I'm not important. I am unworthy. Christ is worthy. Christ is important. I'm just a voice crying out in the wilderness. And I'm just preparing the way for my king. His entire existence was for the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a wonderful life. You might hear about that and you might think, man, what an awful life. He didn't exist for himself, but he existed for another. What about my dreams? What about my aspirations? You know, you might think, but I think that's a wonderful life. And I think to myself, if only I may be like that, where Christ may shine through me, where I just want to be a mouthpiece for the Lord. I don't want to be recognized. I don't want to be seen. I want the cross of Christ to be magnified and for Christ to be seen, not me. I think his life was wonderful, and all glory be to God. But another thing about John the Baptist is that he was a witness to Christ. So he was a pointer to Christ, he was a witness to Christ, and I think those go hand in hand. But what does that mean? When the religious rulers and the people came, they began to question John, like I said, and his job was to witness and to testify that Jesus truly is the Christ. So John had God's given authority, a special authority that was given by God, and it's as though he was in a courtroom and he is being cross-examined, and they're asking him, who are you? Tell us right now, who are you? And his job was to testify and to witness to the truth. That was his job, formally, because he was sent from God. And what do witnesses do? His job was to witness. What do witnesses do? Do they fabricate things? Do they tell their own opinions? Do they give conjectures or give speculations? Are they analysts? No, they're none of these things. A witness simply testifies to the truth. Witness and truth go hand in hand. The witness testifies to the truth. And what was John the Baptist's truth, the truth that he declared? Verse 34, and I have seen and I have borne witness that this is the Son of God. NIV says the chosen one or the Messiah. He's the one whom you're looking for. He's the Son of God. He's the chosen one. Today, I want to focus on one particular verse of John the Baptist's witness. And it's the title for today's message, Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is verse 29. I've just broken it up into three sections of what John said. First, behold. Behold. It says look, but I like behold better, so I'll go with behold. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold. The witness, John the Baptist, is now calling. Can you imagine a crowd? Just like there's a crowd here. John the Baptist has a crowd of people, and he's saying, behold. Behold. He's drawing your attention. He's narrowing your vision, and he's calling upon you to focus and to tunnel your vision upon the person, and that person being the person of Jesus Christ. You know, there's many things in life that are not worthwhile beholding, and yet we do anyways. We behold our careers. We behold our future aspirations and our plans. We behold so many dreams of this life, of just becoming rich in this world, or our stock portfolio just doing really well. We behold so many useless things. But John the Baptist here is saying, stop what you're doing. Get rid of the distractions. Put blinders on. Focus your attention. Focus your gaze. And look upon this one, this one. He's saying there is not a thing that is more important in your life at this very moment than this thing right now. Behold, because Jesus is approaching and he's saying, behold. Secondly, he says, behold the Lamb of God. Now let's talk about the Lamb of God. We already said, this is weird. Lamb of God, what does that mean? Why would you describe somebody as a lamb? That's not... You know, sheep, lamb, they're not exactly why not the tiger? Why not the lion? Why not the bear? You know, some majestic creature. Why not the stallion? But no, he's the Lamb of God. But it's weird for us today, but I think if you were a Jewish person, if you've gone to church before, you've probably read through the book of Genesis. And if you read through Genesis, you're going to come across a figure named Abraham. Well, Abraham, he was chosen by God, and he had a son named Isaac. And God basically, to test Abraham, he commanded Abraham to take Isaac and go up to a mountain and sacrifice his son Isaac. And Abraham, he trusted in the Lord. I'm not saying it was easy, but he trusted in God, and he ends up going up to the mountain. And just as he's ready to bring down the knife to slay his son Isaac, the angel of the Lord, or if he were to just let you go scot-free, God would be unjust. God would be unfair. God would not be holy. But how does God save the world without compromising his own justice? Just like the lamb caught in the thicket in the book of Genesis. Just like the lamb that was slain for Israel in Exodus. Just like the lamb that would die for the sins of his people in Isaiah. Jesus, the Lamb of God, has to die on the cross to forgive sins. Your sins, my sins. It's not sin in general, or sin in the ether, or sin somewhere. It's your sin and my sin. Let's make it personal. It's your sin. It's my sin. It's the sins that you have committed, that you have done. The book of Romans says, for the wages of sin is death. That means the one who sins deserves to die. Okay? Think about your sins at this time. Don't think about the sins of your lifetime, but how about just this week? How about just this past week? How many wicked thoughts that we had? What we did in secret that we thought nobody could see. The wicked desires that we have treasured up in our own hearts. What are the evil thoughts that we have thought about against other people? It's wicked. It is wickedness. It's not sin just in general. And it's not something out there. And when we talk about sin, that Jesus died for sin, don't think of the terrorist or the evil person out there. It's you. It's me. Jesus died for sin, for sinners like you and I. What we need to realize is that sin is against the person of God. We've offended, actually, the person of God. When you have guilt in your heart, we think that sometimes if we just let enough time go by, then that sin is somehow just swept under the rug and it's okay now. That's not what the Bible says. Every careless word, every deed, everything that we've done has been recorded by God. And on that last day, we will be held accountable. So as we see from Scripture, it's either that you need to shed your blood, for the wages of sin is death. You need to shed your blood on account of your own sin, or just like the lamb from the Old Testament, from Genesis, from Exodus, from Isaiah, the Lamb of God needs to shed his blood on your behalf. And that's what the gospel is. And that's how God satisfies his justice and his holiness. That's how God does not bend his justice or his unjust by just letting you go for free. How can the blood of the Lamb be yours? How can the blood of the Lamb be yours? It says, trust and believe in the person of Jesus Christ. It's by faith. Trust and place your faith in the Lamb. Now, I'm calling each and every single one of you. You must respond to what I'm saying. And a non-response in itself is a response. Will you repent and trust in the Lamb today? If you do not repent, if you do not trust in the Lamb, you will be held accountable for your own sin. It's either your blood would be shed, or The blood of the Lamb that has already been shed for you, that can be yours if you will just place your faith and trust in the Lamb. And he'll wipe away all of your sin and all of your filth. And he promises, the promise of Scripture is that he will forgive you. You will be forgiven in Christ. Guys, this is not a condemning message. This is not a condemning message. This is a saving message. Do you see that there's somebody who took that place for you? Just believe in him. Believe in him. Believe in him today. You know, the Old Testament, as I shared, there's a few and scarce reference of the Lamb, but there's a place in the New Testament where the word Lamb is repeated around 30 times. It's the book of Revelation. It talks about the Lamb of God, the Lamb who was slain, the Lamb who was slain. You know, during John the Baptist's time, the Lamb of God came to forgive sins and to wipe away sin, to wash away the sins of the world. But when the Lamb of God from the book of Revelation comes, which is the same Lamb, it's Jesus Christ, he will not come to forgive sins, but he will come to judge. If you read the book of Revelation, it talks about how the Lamb of God, will conquer his enemies. The Lamb of God will come to judge. How the Lamb of God will be seated on his throne. And at that time, there will be no forgiveness then. It will be too late. But it will talk about the church and how the Lamb of God will be married to the church. It will be a glorious day for those who are in Christ. So I implore you, believe in the Lamb. Allow me to close. Have you found the Messiah? Have you found the Messiah? Have you found him? I was thinking, the fact that this very temple exists, the very fact that this religious institution exists, is fact and is proof and parcel that not everybody has found the Messiah. The Jewish people have still not found their Messiah. Have you found the Messiah? He has come. John the Baptist said, and as he's witnessing to you even right now, the words of Scripture, behold the Lamb of God. Escape the judgment of God. Allow him to take away your sin. Jesus is that Messiah. He's the Son of God. He's the one to behold. He's the one who you could trust in. He's the one who you could place your faith in. And he promises to take away your sin and grant you everlasting life. Let us pray. We behold our God seated on the throne as we sang, Lord. We behold our God who is seated on the throne. Lord Jesus, you were spat upon, you were despised, you were ridiculed, and you did not open your mouth. But right now, you are seated on the throne. And Lord, you will come back. And in the second coming of Christ, we know that you will come gloriously with all 10,000 upon 10,000 of your angels, and you'll come to judge the living and the dead. God, may we behold and believe and trust in and place our faith in the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Help us to believe, Lord, and may we find eternal life today. We thank you, God, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll have offering. We'll have offering. Let's give to the Lord. We'll sing a song of praise led by our brother John. And let's give to the Lord. And let's sing and let's give our hearts to the Lord. Lord. At this time, Ms. Soyi is going to come up and give the announcements for us.
Welcome back, everyone. First announcement, we will have Thursday lunch at Jasmine. It's free lunch between 11:30 to 1:30. You can come anytime. Pastor Paul will be there, and I might be there from time to time. So enjoy Thursday lunch, and we will get to know each other and meet pastors and pray together if you have any prayer requests. And also, we have mission planning plan to go to Africa May 20th and June 1st. Between May 20th to June 1st, the flight is fixed, so you can come to ask me or pastor the schedule. It will be really good. We have a 2003 mission trip video at the website and then also at the bulletin, so you can check it out. And lastly, we have a prayer meeting and Bible study coming Saturday at Mission Center this week. So pickup is at 6 o'clock at 11 o'clock. And the prayer meeting starts at 11:15. And then lunch at 12:30 and then Bible study. All right. Thank you.
Right, everyone. Why don't we just stand up and let's just pray just once more. Let's quietly just pray, but let's respond to the Lord. People, this is not my message. This is not my message. It's the message of the Lord. And the Lord, if he's speaking to your heart, respond to him today. You know, John the Baptist, 2,000 years ago, he witnessed to the people, behold the Lamb of God. Guess what? There were some who believed, and there were many who didn't. But nonetheless, there were people who believed and who began to follow. Don't think that Christianity is the faith of your parents or the faith of, you know, just a historic faith or anything like that. And let's not treat Christianity as just coming to church, but let's respond to the Lord. John the Baptist, 2,000 years ago, he said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the Word of God still speaks today, and the Word of God speaks to you, and it says to you, behold the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God. Which means, will you behold? Will you behold? So if you could just quietly just pray and respond to the Lord. Perhaps it's okay to pray, God, perhaps I didn't behold yet, but help me to behold. Help me to behold. I don't know how to behold, or help me to behold the Lamb of God. Help me to trust in you. If you could just quietly just pray once. This time, we'll end with the Lord's Prayer. We'll end with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Praise God. We are dismissed.